Shikha Pathak. I'm the Manager Awareness and Skill Building at SciSec. A very warm welcome to today's webinar. This webinar is a part of SciSec's weekly series titled Samgachhatvam, May We All Progress Together. The objective is to cover various cybersecurity topics and provide conceptual overviews. Let's start with some ground rules. All attendees of the webinar will be on mute by default. We will have a question and answer session at the end of the presentation. In case you have any questions, please share on the chat window and the speakers will respond after the presentation. We will be recording this webinar and the recording will be uploaded on SciSec's YouTube channel. So you can revisit it anytime later. This is the 25th webinar. The topic today is Secure Software Development Lifecycle. Next week, we have an interesting webinar by Deloitte. So stay tuned to our Twitter and LinkedIn page for further updates. Here is a list of our upcoming webinars. In case you want to access the previous videos, they can be accessed on the SciSec YouTube channel. We are hopeful that these webinars will kindle your interest in the field of cybersecurity. SciSec is happy to launch its cybersecurity awareness mascots. You now have a chance to name our mascots and win exciting prizes. So head over to our Twitter account, SciSec COE, to participate in this contest and suggest names for our mascots. You stand a chance to win exciting prizes. As usual, we will have an assessment after this webinar, which will be kept open for 60 minutes. The questions will be from topics which are already covered in this webinar. Those who get 7 or more than 7 marks out of 11 will be provided with a certificate of achievement. Those who are unable to take this assessment will be given a certificate of participation. At the end of the assessment, you will also be asked to provide feedback. Please provide your genuine feedback and be rest assured that it will have no bearing on your assessment. Please provide your details very clearly while taking this assessment, as a certificate will be generated based on these details only. The link of the assessment will be shared in the question and answer chat session. Please note that this assessment is open only to those who have participated in this webinar. Let me now take this opportunity to introduce today's speakers. Today's webinar is in partnership with REBIT, Reserve Bank Information Technology Private Limited. We are glad to have with us Mr. Shailendra Rajput, who works as Senior Manager with the CS Vertical, Cybersecurity Vertical at REBIT. Shailendra has over 14 years of experience. He has worked broadly with the information security domain, with majority into application security. He has been working on development and implementation of the secure software development lifecycle process. He has been assisting software development teams with secure design, development, and deployment. Welcome, Shailendra. We also have with us Mrs. Prajakta Sharma. Prajakta has extensively worked in development and security domain for over 13 years. She has worked in various domains like SSDLC, conducting application and database risk assessment, and driving vendor security risk assessment. Welcome, Prajakta. We look forward to a very enriching session. Now, I will hand over to Shailendra for the rest of the presentation. Welcome, Shailendra and Prajakta. You may start your presentation now.
Thanks. I'm audible?
Yes, Shailendra, you're audible.
Hope I'm audible. Yeah. So, and my screen is also visible, right?
Yeah, your screen is visible, yes. Please go ahead.
Okay. Thanks a lot. So thanks, Shika. Good evening, all. So today we are going to discuss about the importance of security into software development lifecycle. Right. So we hear about, you know, this security into SDLC lot many times, you know, be it any discussions, you know, with the development teams or maybe security team. But the more important is the how significantly and the awareness is among the teams. So just to provide a broad overview, what we are going to cover today in the session, the importance of SSDLC and the roadmap, the different SSDLC activities, the threat importance of threat modeling and application security testing, the software composition analysis and software security assurance models. We'll touch base DevOps and the importance of DevSecOps, CI/CD pipeline and security. Finally, best practices and tools. So now, why security is in SDLC or software development, right? So before directly jumping into the topic, right, we need to understand the criticality of this particular aspect, right? So what actually is leading, you know, organizations concerned about this particular, you know, security into SDLC. So let's see certain breaches happened in the past to understand, you know, the importance of this particular topic. So there was a hack into the Facebook site due to a weakness in a particular Facebook code, which lead to leakage of particularly the access tokens, or they, in their terminology, the digital keys of around 50 million users. Similarly, there was a major attack on the Equifax, which is a credit bureau company. Around, this is a, so far called the largest cybercrime related identity theft, wherein 150 million US citizens, you know, credit card information along with few British and Canada based citizens were stolen. And the reason behind was that was there was an open source component being used, Apache Struts, which has published a vulnerability in a time frame wherein organization would have implemented as a, when it was a zero-day attack. However, Equifax missed to apply the patch in a timely manner, and there was a 3 months delay, and it was the vulnerability was exploited by the attackers. Similarly, there was an attack on the Uber database, a particular Uber data where drivers and customers' personal information was stolen. And this was just because of a very, very, you know, I would say not a minor issue, but yes, it lead to a devastating, you know, results. So what happened is that the developers used the, you know, common collaboration source code tools, repository tools like GitHub and all. And the, so the, they left the credentials inside the particular code, which was got into the hands of attackers. And finally, they were able to get into the Uber infrastructure and steal the data. So now, having said these three scenarios, there could be a list of multiple scenarios, right? How, having said these scenarios, what we see, the reasons behind, you know, the attacks prevalent in the software is more from a weakness in the source code, right? Improper use of third-party code libraries and product, wherein, you know, vulnerable versions of product libraries are being used. At some point, you must have seen, you know, in, for example, in Facebook site also, right? Even though it's a, such a renowned and reputed organization, there is a lack of, you know, secure coding practices, or maybe lack in some design. The Facebook scenario actually is a flaw in the design, where, you know, the controls in the requirement design. You know, if you think of from a, you know, Uber data breach or Equifax also, if these things would have been well planned during the requirement and design, maybe the attack perspective would have been, you know, lowered. And finally, the very foremost and very important thing, even though we follow a secure SDLC, right, we, it's not a one-time activity, it's a continuous process. And to have that in place, we make sure that we, whenever change happens in a deployed code, right, that undergoes a proper change management process, and the changes are reviewed from perspective, more importantly. So moving ahead, having said this, if you summarize the importance of secure SDLC, we need to have the project team discuss about the project plan. We need to have a security plan to be ingrained, incorporated into the project plan. It's like hard coding into the project plan itself, so that every line item, every activity which has to be followed as part of different stages of software development lifecycle are ingrained there and followed. Again, as I mentioned, security is a continuous process. So what it's actually leading to, as I said, it's not a one-time activity, it's a continuous process. So it's actually leading an awareness amongst the application team, project team, and giving them a feel, right, and the importance of this particular aspect. They definitely would, you know, it learn with the time, and this would mature with the time. And then a homegrown secure coding standard practice, which could be, you know, governed by some standards across the industry. Then you make your developers skilled in writing secure code. It also helps you detecting the security risk very early. And finally, you reduce overall cost, effort, time taken for fixing security defects later. So to begin with, we need to define a SDLC roadmap. How do we define? We define all the security related activities and the relevant deliverables and document that as SDLC framework. We have organization security policies, right? Make sure that what the available information security policy in an organization has a mandate of to follow secure software development process. And accordingly, we define a standard operating procedure. So what will actually this lead to? This will actually make a sort of a mandatory part of a process wherein all development activity must undergo through a secure software development lifecycle process. And finally, there are certain regulations, compliances, standards, and guidelines which has to be adhered, right? For example, the data privacy regulation, a GDPR, or maybe the Data Protection Bill of India, which should soon be, right? Those also govern and clearly highlights the importance of protection of data. Similarly, PCI DSS, Payment Card Industry Data Security Standard, and ISO 27001. And then we definitely can follow the certain guidelines available, like OWASP, OPA, Application Security Project, and SANS. So going ahead, now we will discuss about the different SDLC activities during each stages of software development. So as I mentioned, planning stage. When you are defining a project plan, you make sure that we have a security SME, right, as a part of our project plan, who will be a sort of a point of contact for you. And as and when needed, he can be can bring in the SMEs from different cybersecurity verticals wherever required. So that plan should incorporate all the critical security activities. And secondly, all the technical discussion happening as a part of planning process, we make sure that cyber security team is definitely part of all those discussions and meetings. What eventually will happen is that he would, right from the beginning, he will start drafting and documenting all the required controls, or maybe the from a hardware or from a software perspective or from a design architecture, everything. And he can help you design and gather the right security requirements for the project. Then moving on to the requirement phase, from a security perspective, we make sure that all the security controls with respect to application and infrastructure are documented. Access control requirements are well documented again, as per the application, right? Whatever. And then we clearly identify, list down all the assets and mark the criticality against them. That essentially means classify the particular asset in terms of the criticality, maybe secret, public, confidential. And then accordingly define controls for protection. We also have to make sure that what all applicable compliance and regulations are applicable, we also, our application should also adhere to that. And to come to that, we need to visualize the application from that perspective, whether we need to have PCI DSS compliant or any other compliant or any data privacy protection requirement compliance and all to meet the compliance requirement. And then you review all the required technology stack, do a sort of SCA, software composition analysis. You define the strategy for the deployment, how this product would be, application would be deployed in the production, and what all components from a security perspective need to be integrated. And then finally, on this requirement, complete activity, what we have done so far, right, from the top to the bottom, we need to do a sort of a risk assessment to identify whether we haven't missed anything in the requirement from a security perspective. Now, moving on to the design, definitely architectural design, drafting and, you know, a sort of HLD, LLD is the very first thing which we begin in the design phase. Henceforth, from a security perspective, we need to do a proper security review of this design and architecture. We ingrain threat modeling processes to identify the prospective threats and the related vulnerabilities. We define hardening guidelines for the respective underlying hardwares, or to some extent certain softwares also. We define security configuration checklist pointers. We define certain vendor security assessment point checklist. This is applied wherein a third party vendor is involved in developing application. What all security practices they have is very also equally important. So from a perspective like securing your proprietary code, which is being developed by the vendor, I just take an example. So it is important that we conduct a vendor security assessment to analyze the security aspects at their end. We define application logs for integration with SIEM. All the required events to be captured by the application when the application is running and the respective log parameters. For example, any authentication and authorization failure should be captured by the application and need to be integrated the SIEM for the monitoring purpose. So this thing all capturing right here. That is what actually I'm trying to bring here. We are actually, you know, building a secure foundation so that at the later stage, we don't, you know, get into hiccups or any delays and things like that. And then again, logs for forensic, then defining very important thing, data security controls in transit, at rest and in use. How, what, and what measures has to be taken while the data is in transit, rest and use. Just to iterate one example here, for example, when the data is in transit, right, what controls you have to apply when a password is being, you know, transferred from source or destination? And at the same time, what security control you're going to apply when a sensitive data like Aadhaar number or credit card number or something like that is being traversing from the source to destination? So the controls could differ here, and you need to understand what right control has to be applied, right? And similarly for the data at rest and in data in use. And then after all this activity we have done with the requirement design, there are chances that some of the identified security measures the application team, due to some reasons, are not able to implement, or they have highlighted that this may or may not be implemented or something like that. That definitely is a risk here, so far concluded risk after the requirement design. And that has to be raised as an exception and highlighted to the senior manager so that teams are aware that these are the exceptions here, okay? And accordingly, we have to work to mitigate those risks. It is not like that if there's risk, we just go ahead. We have to think from what all compensatory controls are there, which could minimize the risk, and hence we have the residual risk, and then finally we look into the aspect how we can minimize the residual risk. Moving ahead from design to development. Now, when all these aspects have been considered, we make sure that with these controls, what we have defined in the requirement design, all this, what all has to be met in the development should be met. That is a very important aspect here. Development flaws actually lead to most of the attacks, major percentage of the attacks. So the very first thing is that you have to well plan that either your developer is skilled in writing a secure code or you get them trained. So they need to understand the importance of secure coding. It's just not developing an application and giving a project on time, given timelines. And similarly, a secure coding best practice as a part of organization standard can be built and can be used by the developers. So that gives assistance or help to the developers. And developers should also be capable of or skilled in running tools like SAST, static application security testing. So it's just a source code scanner tool which helps them identify the bugs, security defects in the code. After this, we move on to the testing phase, wherein we do DASH, dynamic application security testing, which is testing which is done from the functional functionality perspective, being scanned on the user interfaces. Then we have another technology being used, interactive application security testing, that can also be used here. We take the application through vulnerability assessments, wherein application infrastructure both comes under the scope. This is something like manual testing, and the security risk assessment, wherein we perform a proper risk assessment. This is a very different process apart from vulnerability assessment and application security testing, wherein the assessor actually sit with the developers of the project team and helps understand the controls, configurations, architecture, and all, and try to list whether there are any gaps still there in the application that can be highlighted. Moving on, once all these activities are done, when we are going for a deployment, as I mentioned in the requirement phase, we need to actually capture all the requirement from the deployment perspective, right? For example, application logs I was talking about. So now when we are in this phase, since we have already considered the deployment requirements, it should be more or less a smooth process. However, we make sure that all the required controls or products need to be integrated from an infrastructure side. The data center gets integrated with the application, like SIM, security information, event management, web application firewall, WAF, database security monitoring. It could be more. And then at the network security related IDS, IPS, antivirus. And then from a secure access perspective, privileged identity management tools. Then from a database security, you apply vaulting and encryption or maybe transparent data encryption. After all this, the list could be more. Actually, we have highlighted just a few more. It could be more, actually speaking. After all this is being done, we make sure that we do a full-fledged penetration testing here of the application from a real attacker's perspective. That will give a feel that from an attacker's perspective also the application is being tested. At this stage, it is completely on the organization side whether they can hire a third-party vendor or they can do it from a internal security team. And finally, all this process, multiple layers of security we have done, we again review our previous exception form and finalize, conclude on the additional risk. We add to the additional risk and conclude on the final risk. So that's what are the final risks which needs to undergo a sign off. As I mentioned, we need to analyze those risks. We need to look what all compensatory controls are there, and finally come to a conclusion what are actual risks, and then highlight to the management saying these are the risks and has to be considered in considering the criticality. One important step is that when we are going through each and every stages of this software development, as I mentioned, the different security activities being carried out, we make sure that there is a proper sign off process from requirement to design to development, this test development testing and testing to deployment. So there's a proper security sign up. And then finally, when we are done all this activity and the application is gone live, okay, we come into an operation and maintenance process, which is a periodic activities wherein we should have a proper patch management. We do a proper patching of the application running. We have a proper change management wherein all the changes undergo a change review, as mentioned in the initial slides. And all the change undergo a security review, wherever required to undergo a security review, and if required, it should also undergo a security assessment. And then we need to review all the user access reviews. Access review in the sense of from user deletion, transition, recertification, when a user is moving out, a new user is getting onboarded. So there should be no dormant users running into an ecosystem, something like that. So these are the very critical SSG activities we just covered and the related security elements in each stage. Now, moving on to the, see, this is the security activities in the, from holistic purpose. If you see, there are different software development methodologies being used across organization. And all this activity very smoothly gets fit into those models. For example, like this, you know, the old fashioned model, like waterfall model, it is all the security elements gets properly incorporated into the software development life cycle. For example, the requirement analysis, design, development, testing, release. If you see that, just the same thing we just discussed. The risk assessment, the threat modeling and design phase, the starting list. I've just highlighted few of the activities. However, the list, comprehensive list we just discussed is equally applicable. Similarly, when we go into when we have agile development strategy, we have this requirement design. However, the development test activity is an iterative activity. So we can ingrain all the security activities we just discussed. For example, the requirement design, all activities as it is can be ingrained. And when we do a development test in multiple iterations, so the periodic SAS scanning, that is static analysis, which is mentioned here, dynamic analysis, that's DAST, we mentioned dynamic applications with security testing. So all those can be incorporated into the agile development. And similarly, for the deployment and the final sign-off. The sign-off, when I say, obviously the sign-off is based on the exceptions and the risk acceptance. And then the DevSecOps. So we will touch base in more detail at the later stage. So we have just depicted like all the security activities can again be ingrained here. And then the security measures at each stage of the development can be taken care. Now I will touch base a few of the important aspects which we discussed, we talked about in the SSDSC activities. So for example, we threat modeling. This is one of the important aspects wherein we consider that as a part of security assessment, this should be carried out. It's a systematic approach to analyze, first to identify all the assets related to a particular application being developed. The asset, how these assets are getting fit into the design and architecture. And then on the basis of that, we identify the threats and vulnerabilities. So how it is achieved? During the threat modeling, the application is actually decomposed or you can say broken into multiple workflows. Essentially, the data flow diagrams, you can say. And then each workflow or a data flow diagram is analyzed for the possible threats. So those data flow diagrams, teams review that, security teams look into the aspect from the asset perspective, is there any weakness and things like that, and highlight the applicable vulnerabilities associated to that threat model and the possible risk there. So that's what I mentioned, just like the third point, analyze each workflow possible threat and hence provide mitigation. So how it helps is that it actually helps the development teams, the project teams, to define a very secure design and provide the appropriate security controls or the required coding standards there, or you can say secure coding standards there. There are some methods already available for this threat model, like Stride, PASTA, and Octave, which can be ingrained for to carry out a threat model. So Stride is a Microsoft defined model which is more mature, which talks about, which actually categorizes in the threats into this STRIDE. So S stands for spoofing, then T for tampering, reputation, information disclosure, denial of service, and finally E is for the elevation of privileges. So under each category, there could be multiple vulnerabilities, right? So that is the way this Stride model has been defined. And similarly, PASTA and Octave also are used, but this is more risk-centric. But Stride is purely from an application perspective, including the risk-centric. So it is driven by a threat ranking model, which is known as DREAD also. So moving on to another aspect is that application security testing, which we talked about in our security activities. So under application security testing, there could be two modes of doing an application security assessments or testing. One is the automated and another one is the manual. So the, under the automated thing, we have different categories of testing. We have touched base this. I will just elaborate more on this thing. So one is the SAST, static application security testing. It's a kind of white box testing to identify vulnerabilities at the source code or the binary level. So it scans the provided code and it gives you the result as a list of vulnerabilities there in the code. It also points to the specific functions where the code is there. The vulnerability is there. Similarly, we have DAST. It's a sort of a black box testing, which, as I mentioned, does the scanning on the functional UI, from a functionality perspective on the UI, wherein you do a scanning on a runtime environment on a running application, and then conclude on the vulnerabilities. Now, there is another approach which is known as IAST, Interactive Application Security Testing. The Interactive Application Security Testing is actually coming into picture due to the certain gaps in the DAST and SAST. That is the reason this new approach of testing is coming or has recently been coined. For example, when you do a DAST scanning, DAST actually can let you know the vulnerabilities on the interface level. Okay, this is on a particular input field, the inputs are not properly validated. That's it. But it doesn't let you know where in code that actually weakness is there. On the other side, you do a SAST scanning, which actually scans the code, but you don't have a visibility how this weakness in code can be exploited from the UI perspective. Now the IST, what it does is that it is actually a combination of both, wherein when an application team tests the application from a user UI perspective, whatever inputs are being coming, right? From a malicious input perspective, it identifies, okay, this is a weakness, and it also points to the code where that weakness is. Essentially, it is not doing a SAST scanning, okay? But it is actually telling the developers where the vulnerability is. It's doing sort of DAST scanning and telling the developers where the vulnerability is. It actually has an agent-based approach which is kept in the application during the testing time. And that agent actually helps you point to that particular code where the vulnerability is. So it doesn't mean that it actually neglects the use of SAST. It definitely says it is like SAST and the IST can be used in combination, something like that. Or maybe a SAST and DAST. So it depends completely on the organization's requirement. And then hence the combination of the tools can be used. Most recently, there is a new technology which is coming as known as RASP, Runtime Application Self-Protection. What it does is, it is actually a runtime version of IST, I would say like that. Why? Because IST is doing the thing when we are doing a testing in application. However, the RASP runs in a real-time environment when the application is live and running. It is again an agent-based approach where it sits in an application and not an exactly an application, but it sits in where the application is deployed and captures any malicious traffic coming on HTTP and let the developers or the monitoring know there is a malicious traffic coming and can raise a block and take an action. So these are the four different automated approaches to test an application. Now moving on to the manual approach. So we talked about the white box. We just mentioned SAST, right? So white box can be in two different forms. One is in the automated, we talked about SAST, and the other could be the manual source code review. So that's what I mentioned here. Depending on today's, scenario of a developed application, number of lines of code, this is a really time consuming activity. So most of the organization doesn't go for this, and they better feel that SAST could be done. And then is your gray box testing, which is nothing but your vulnerability assessments being done on the application infrastructure, right? Not just with the use of tool, but however using the manual approach also, the vulnerability assessment. And then your black box testing, which is again something like a test dashed, right? We run a scanning tool on the interface level to find out the vulnerabilities flaws in the functional analytics. So that's what I've just mentioned here. So white box, gray box, and black box, source code review, vulnerability assessment, penetration testing, vulnerability assessment, application infrastructure. And then one more thing we talked about, penetration testing. So it's a one layer ahead of vulnerability assessment. So we do a vulnerability assessment, obviously, and we find a vulnerability and report to the teams. But when we do a penetration testing, we actually try to exploit that and, you know, tell the teams, okay, this could lead to so-and-so attack. So it's like a step ahead. So this is the difference, you know, when we say application testing in terms of malware and automated. Now, moving on to another important aspect is software composition analysis. So the software composition analysis, it's actually a process based on certain tools which helps an organization identify the vulnerabilities or security risk or any licensing issues in an open source software or a component library being used in an application. So nowadays, I mean, there is a lot, there's very much use of open source softwares and technologies, right? So we have to make sure that whatever application we are developing, so partially the code could be in-house developed, but if whatever open source codes and libraries we're using, we make sure that that is properly analyzed for any risk and vulnerability. And then here comes your SCA. Such tools really helps you to identify such weaknesses in the code and also let you know any licensing concerns also. So for that to have in place, again, as I mentioned, it should be part of your process, policies, and framework. That SCA process is definitely should be followed, so that any weakness due to open source cannot be exploited by an attacker and it is timely patched. Just the way I mentioned about the example of Equifax attack had. Now, having said that, it is very much important. See, this activity we are always carrying out when we are developing an application. We incorporate, we do the scanning, we tell the teams, okay, there's a gap in, you know, open source libraries and things like that. But the concern here is that when the application is live, it should be a continuous process, and where we do have a monitoring, we do have a monitoring approach there. We define a monitoring process there. How we are going to monitor the risk of open source software in real time. So again, HCA can help you there. It can actually help you monitor risk while the application is in operation. So it is very much important that all the open source libraries vulnerabilities are fixed in timely manner, and it shouldn't happen that any of the open vulnerability there is a delay in fixing that or something like that, which could, you know, put our application on risk. Now, moving on to software security assurance models. This is something like, bringing, so let's say you have already a defined secure software development lifecycle framework or a process. These assurance models actually helps you, you know, mature your processes. So there are certain, proven software assurance maturity model, which can be used to assess the existing secure software development lifecycle processes. So one of them is like OpenSAM. So OpenSAM is a sort of a self-assessment framework which can be used. It is from OWASP, which is based on four major business functions: governance, construction, verification, and operation. So under which there are 12 security practices it is much more in detail there. So I'll just highlight at a high level that one should always try to adopt this models, one of these models, to periodically assess the underlying secure software development strategies and methods there in the organization and see if there is a scope for improvement, and hence you mature your models timely. So similarly, we have BSIMM, Building Security and Maturity Model. It is also on the same track. There is a slight difference. OpenSAM has predefined policies, standard, but BSIMM is based on the reviews from the organizations. So it actually incorporate many organizations on a timely manner and understand from them how different organizations actually following secure SGLC. And the learning from there is incorporated into BSIMM. So it is that way it is developed. So we have Microsoft SDL also. Similarly, we have Safe Code, Software Assurance Forum for Excellence Code. So more or less, most of these models are very much same. I mean, it is that. I mean, it's all are open source. Either of them or a combination of them can be used to mature the secure software development lifecycle processes. One more aspect is that I would just like to touch is there is a similar security framework defined by PCI DSS. Wherever the application is being developed from requirement perspective to meet the compliance of PCI DSS as per requirement number 6.3 out of their 12 requirements. So it's 6.3 actually says of secure software development, which needs to be adhered by an organization when they are developing a application, payment related application, which would hold the cardholders' data. So in addition to that, we also defined a PCI software security framework, which actually replaces the previous PADSS, Payment Application Data Security Standard. So this framework also can be considered when you are actually developing an application for an organization which actually comes under the compliance of PCI DSS. So we just want to say that whenever an application is developed, we have to make sure that all the related compliance are well studied, well understood, and all the requirements are well met by the application, so that there is no gap when an audit is happening as per the compliance, be it any compliance, be it any regulation. And hence, this is very much important that right from the beginning, the security into SDLC is being followed. Moving on to the next aspect is we will just drive you through the strategies for security into DevOps and the concept of DevSecOps. So over to you, Prajata, you can take it over from here.
Thank you, Shailender. I will now share my screen. Is my screen visible?
Yes, Prajakta, please go ahead.
Okay, thank you, Shikha. So we'll now travel through the journey into DevOps and its security. Okay. So to understand what DevOps is, we will just have a peek into the life of a developer, who is Tom, and operations team member, who is Jerry. So one day what happens is, there is Mickey and Minnie. They met in a coffee shop. Minnie wants to understand what the DevOps is. So Mickey tries to explain. So there are two characters. One is Tom and other is Jerry. Tom is in dev development team and Jerry is in operation team, that is dev and ops. So what happens is Tom, that's a developer, writes code, and Jerry, who is the ops, is responsible to deploy code into production and maintain servers, configurations, etc. So Tom and Jerry have separate departments, separate cubicles, and they do not talk to each other often. So what happens is every time there is a deployment, there were a lot of issues. There were a lot of trust issues between Tom and Jerry. Tom always said that he tested and the code works in the development. And Jerry always said that the configuration of your environment is different from the production and many such things. Nobody used to take the ownership of the failures. So that is what happens, right, in the real environment also. So yes, so they had a lot of trust issues. Then what happened one day was Tom saw Jerry in a company's food court and he decided to approach and talk to her. This was a turning point. They slowly and gradually started talking and sharing their issues, work, and what work that they were doing in their respective areas. While talking, Jerry just mentioned that last production deployment failed due to some values in the configuration file that was as per the dev environment, and stressed that it took her entire night to figure out and fix that. To this, Tom replied, "You would have called me. It was just a few minutes job for me." See, that's what happens, right? When the dev and ops don't talk, the ops really don't know what are the configurations done by the dev team. So yes, and similarly, they talked on many such instances and issues in the past they could have easily resolved if they have collaborated in a better way. So this is what happens everywhere, right? We just need to talk and discuss the issues and sort it out. So after the long discussions, Tom and Jerry decided to work together. They started collaborating with each other shared knowledge and responsibilities. One day, Tom suggested we could have a separate configuration file for every environment, and that can save a lot of time and unnecessary issues. Jerry agreed happily. Other day, Jerry suggested that having a dev environment exactly like the production configuration could help them to catch all possible deployment issues much earlier, and Jerry could do that in minutes. To this, Tom also agreed because it was in both of them's interest. Tom and Jerry started spending a lot of time together, discussing work, issues, and thinking more and better ways to make the software development and delivery process better, efficient, and faster. One day, Tom suggested automating the testing of the code that will save a lot of time. Jerry agreed and suggested to have automated deployment after automated testing. Right? So this is how they started to find out and research if any tools that can be used for testing and deployment process. And then they thought of processes and tools to automate other workflows and monitoring process. So what do we learn over here? We understand that it is not a process, not a tool or a technology. It is a process, right? Not a tool or a technology. It is a process of collaboration, communication, working together, automation, and improving the process in the life cycle of the delivery process. So what do we understand over here? There were a couple of drivers that led into the establishment of the DevOps, right? There were challenges that when the dev and ops worked in silos, there were a number of challenges. So that resulted into the building of DevOps. So we'll discuss what are the drivers of the DevOps. So one thing is, if you see the diagram here, there are, we have mentioned that a lot of different drivers like business agility, agile development, and testing, and so on. So I'll give an example how this flows. Right? Consider there is a one example. Like government has issued a gold bond that people can purchase. Now there are three competitors into it. One is HDFC Bank, ICICI Bank, and Citibank. Now all of three banks has to launch this gold bond so that the customers can buy them. Nowadays nobody goes to the bank and purchase. Everything needs to be online. So what happens is HDFC banks has a shorter span of development. So it launches the program the next day. Then you have the ICICI Bank. It has 2 days. In 2 days, it will launch the program. Citibank will launch it in 3 days. It will launch it in 3 days. So what happens is, obviously the other two banks are losing out on customer because whichever option they are readily available, the customers will of course go for that buy, right? So the other two banks are at loss. So this agility was there in the business. Now what happens is that when the bank knows that I have to launch this product, I want to launch this bond online, they will look up to their IT department and expect that IT should develop this product as soon as possible with the security and then launch it on the site the next day. You know, with traditional processes, it was not possible. It is not possible because you'll have requirements, you have that entire life cycle that needs to be done. Then at the end, there will be testing, there will be bugs and a lot of issues. But no, now you cannot have this long journey that can be, you know, fulfilled to just launch one product. So agile development was required. Agile testing. I cannot wait till the entire product is developed and then we'll do the testing. No, we need to do it as and when the one build is and then we get tested. As the source code is checked in, the build is done, and then it gets tested so fast. We need that agile development and testing. Infrastructure automation. If the application is built from scratch, we need the environments as soon as possible. We cannot wait for the entire process of setting up, procuring, and then setting up infrastructures with the same configurations as we wanted. So that infrastructure automation also needs to be placed. Nowadays, it's called infrastructure as code. So that also needs to be done. Then we have proactive operations. So now once the product goes online, traditionally what used to happen was business comes to know from their end customers that the application is down. Then the business will tell the development team, the application is down. So what happens is, see, there is a delay over here. Instead, we need to have proactive operations. The operations by themselves should know that my application is not working. Oh, there is an error here. Oh, this is not working well. So the operations team should have their monitoring processes in place. only identify the site is not available, and then we have the continuous feedback and visibility, right? When a product is developed, so when we have a shorter span in developing products, right, we'll have continuous testing. When you have continuous testing, the bugs are resolved then and there, unless you have to wait for the, like, in the traditional ways, you have to wait for the entire time and then go and do the testing and then identify the bugs and vulnerabilities and then do it. So this was the drivers, like all of these were the requirement of time, the requirement of business. There were a lot of competitions, and then this had to be done, and then the DevOps came into picture. Now you must be wondering, where is security in all this? So here it is. Security, if you see, security is everywhere. Security in each phase is everywhere. So the another driver was a security. When there was a shorter timeline to complete the development, what used to happen was there were compromises on security, which cannot be, cannot be the case. The developers can focus on functional testing because that is the bread and butter of the organization. And the business couldn't see the security, and that used to fall back, right? That cannot be the condition right now. Security has to be an ingrained process in every phase of the cycle. So that was it. So then we have DevSecOps into picture. So if you see, this is a continuous loop. From the development, we get the business requirement, then we develop, we deploy, we do continuous improvements, we'll have KPIs in place. We need to continuously monitor, keep improving the, streamline it, and then we draw analysis, we do the statistics, what is going well, what is not going well, we fine-tune it, and then it goes back to the business requirement, then the develop. If you see, security is at the heart, is at the core of the DevSecOps, right? So security has to be ingrained into DevSecOps. So now let's widen the lens. This is the definition, this industry definition of what DevOps is. DevOps is a software development process that emphasizes communication and collaboration. See, we discussed, right, the Tom and Jerry, they had to collaborate to understand each other's issues. So likewise, emphasizes communication and collaboration between the product management, software development, and operations professor. We have different teams working on one product, and then they just cannot sit in silos because their objective is one. That is the efficiency of the product. So that one objective had to be met. It aims to shorten the system's development life cycle and provide continuous delivery with high software quality. That's what it is. We have to do frequent changes. We have to do frequent deployments onto the productions. We just couldn't do that in earlier cycles. So we needed to have this in place. So on my right, you see a funnel, DevOps. So here it is. Automation. What is DevOps? It's automation of processes. We'll have different processes in place. You just name a process, it should be there. Collaboration of people, different teams working on the same application. There should be collaboration amongst them and the integration of those. How do you manage it? How do you manage different processes, automation of processes, collaboration of people? You need tools for that. So you need integration of tools, right? So that how what it is, automating, and then you have collaboration and the integration of tools. I will explain the figure on your left. So this is the flow. If you see inside, we have plan, then develop, test, deploy, and operate. How this works is, imagine there is a, in the bank, there is a withdraw model. Now the industry, so this bank comes up, this business comes to the development team and says that I want to introduce a withdraw module. So then we'll have the product owner will then capture it in the backlog, and then the life cycle of this epic will be tracked through the tools, like we have different tools, and that will be tracked. Now this is business planning. So this is business planning, and from business planning, it will go to development. So in development, we have collaborative developments. Collaborative development, you need collaborative tools, you need VCs, you need links, you need messengers, you need Trello, different tools to collaborate at that level. And then you need IDs that should be connected. You need one source code repository. So the development is also collaborated. The developer now develops it. Now next is your continuous testing. Now what happens is when the developer checks the code into the source code, the automation should enable that the checked in code should be built. If there is a build fail, the developer knows that the code which has been checked in has some errors due to which the build has failed. So what the developer will make the changes, will fix the code and again check in, and the build is successful. Once the build is successful, immediately testing needs to be done. Automated testing, functional testing, and everything needs to be done. So we are sure whatever has been checked in, whatever the build product is right, is functionally right. Then you have continuous release and developments. After every approvals, one after every successful checks, you need approvals in place, you need management approvals. It goes on to the higher environments. You need to have different testing in place. You need to do task scans, you need to do pen testings, you need to container hardenings, everything. So in this is continuous release and development. You check in a code, the build is done automatically, the tests are done automatically. After the approval, it is then released to the production environment, and so on. Then once the application is live, it needs to be continuously monitored for live vulnerability scans on traffic. It needs to be monitored, the HTTP traffic needs to be monitored, it needs to be monitored for threats, network issues, this, that, everything needs to be monitored. You need to have tools in place to monitor it live. You just cannot have a business just to check if the application is working, not working. You need to have tools in place for that. And then you have the collaborative customer feedback and optimization. This is the key thing, that shorter feedbacks. For example, the timeline here, the developer know what he has coded. Now he is getting feedback. The test that is performed immediately once the build is done, he knows what is the functional issues, what are the functional errors. After that, you have security testing. Security testing, the developer knows he's well aware of the context, what he has developed. And so these are shorter feedbacks. So once you have shorter feedbacks, it is easy to fix them. It is quickly done, right? And it improves the performance. And here everywhere is security, of course. During the threat business planning, you need to do threat modeling. Shailendra has explained how and what is threat modeling. Then on collaborative development, you need to do SAS scans, then you will have testing, you will have task scans, pen testing. You need to have VA scans done on periodic basis. It needs to be monitored. Then you have security plugins at each phases so that the developers get collaborative feedbacks at each and every phase. So the adoption journey of DevOps is, earlier, if you see here, two circles, dev and ops were in silos. Then there was a cultural shift. The silos were broken. And now there is a collaboration among the cross-functional teams. A CI/CD pipeline is built. It's automated. You will have build, test, and deploy into it. The feedback is shared across all the teams. So now they're working in a collaborative way. And the next step is, they are together, they are embedded. The dev and ops is just one team. It's no separate teams. It's just embedded into each other. So that we have continuous improvement. The pipeline that was built needs to be fine-tuned, monitored, the test-driven deployments, developments, early detection of failures, because every time it's check-in is done, you did a build, you just get it earlier detection of failures. And then you have maximum code ownership. What is maximum code ownership? We saw in the case of Tom and Jerry, what used to happen when, if there was a deployment failure, Tom used to say, hey, look, the code was working completely fine in development. And in the operation, Jerry used to say, no, it's not working in production. It's something is wrong in the code. And developer used to say, something is wrong in the production environment. So there was no ownership earlier. Right now, it will be the ownership will lie with the developer. So if you see the pink box over here, in the pink box, what it is? It is all about the security. So everywhere you will have security into picture. Nothing works without the security now. Then the benefits of continuous integration. What are the benefits of continuous integration? Frequently integrating small changes. So what does this mean? So we are continuously integrating. We have small pieces of codes, right? We have small modules. We have small modules and we have to integrate them from multiple developers. So when we have to do that, that was not possible earlier. We have now set the pipeline. It's all automated. You just need to check in the code and it will be integrated. The pipeline needs to be set. Automated building and testing. The moment you check in into the source code, the next tool would be to build it. The build will be after the build. Automated testing, the test scripts will be run. The code, when the developer writes the code, his next task will be to write the test scripts. So test scripts will be executed to the piece of code that he has written. So the testing will be done. That's all automated. Now, what happens due to all these things, right? Your shortest span, right? Development is on a shorter span. Issues are identified earlier in the life cycle. So what does this mean? For example, your organization policies, no nested for loops, right? So what will the developer do? He develops one module, does a build, and the testing happens. In the testing, the policies, the organization policies are embedded into it. The testing says that, oh, you have done nested for loops, you have to remove it. It requires very less time for the developer to remove these few nested for loops. Imagine in the traditional life cycle, the entire application would have been built, then a test case to be run, and then testing would say that, oh, you have done nested for loops, and then he had to change it in each and every module. Now, when he's developing the next module, he will not be repeating the same mistake of having embedded for loops. So you understand, so issues are identified earlier in the life cycle, and that is cost effective. You understand, this is cost effective. The developer will not repeat the same mistakes in his other modules because it has already been identified in first module. And that will be high performance. The later on, because all these issues and all will be rectified in the early stages, you'll get high performance. Benefits of continuous delivery. Frequently deploy latest applications build. Sometimes the organization requires, I give you an example of the gold bonds, right? The bank, as soon as it is announced, the bank needs to publish it. The sooner they publish it on their online portal, the more customers they can avail, right? Customers can avail it. The later, the customers will not have it. So, you know, the banks will be losing out the business. So it is a requirement with the DevSecOps, you will get frequently deploy latest application build. Deployment issues are identified earlier in the life cycles. Your environments, all your environments are of the same configurations, right? So in that, what happens is your deployment issues are identified earlier in the life cycle. So you do not, so your production deployments do not take that much time that it used to take earlier because, you know, the issues were not known. And now, because after every build, it's going to be deployed into the higher environments, which is exactly the same, it's going to be an easy task when deploying into the production. Provisioning and configuration of infrastructure all are automated. So that's how it is. So you can have infrastructure as code. You just have scripts and you just need to execute a script and your VM. For example, you execute a script and then you'll have a VMware with all the same IS settings as you wanted, and it can be replicated for all the VMs across. So you are having an infrastructure as a code. So that's also going to help you. So these are all the benefits of your DevSecOps. This is the basic CI/CD pipeline. In the basic CI/CD pipeline, if you see, there's a version control. The developer will check in their code into version control. They will build the solution. Then there will be test cases that will happen. Then the code will be deployed to the higher environments. Then there will be automated tests. Then after approvals, it will be deployed to production. And of course, we'll have monitor and observe it. So if you see, there are arrows here, right? There are arrows that goes back. So these are feedbacks. So after build, if there are any feedbacks or if there are any build issues or anything, it goes back, right? There are feedbacks here. What are the some of the best practices? Security practices needs to be shifted left as part of the CI/CD lifecycle. Security in architecture and design. So what happens is security that needs to be shifted as left, right? We discussed. So you in traditional life cycles, the SSDLs life cycles, what happened was the security testing was done right at the end. If you see the second point, security in architecture and design. So SSDLC does mandates that security needs to be ingrained in right at the beginning, right at the architecture and design, right from the planning basically, and then you have your requirements gathering and everything. But these are all manual processes. How will the security person identify that whatever controls he has suggested or whatever defects he has identified in the architecture, security defects he has identified in the architecture, are incorporated or not? That visibility is not there. Unless you have something like an automated checks that can be done on a shorter span, right? A small module is developed, scans are done, tests are done, and you get a report right in front of you if those are incorporated or not. So, you know, so that is what you'll have your security practices right from the beginning. It's a left shift approach, right from your requirements phase and everything. Then your sensitive informations like certificates, keys, and everything that needs to be stored in vaults. Dependencies should be used from secured sources. So what does this mean? Your application will have dependencies. So let's take an example. This dependency is developed by another department in your organization. You are reusing it. Now, currently, your application is pointing to this dependency stored, the dependency stored in their organization repository. Of course, when the department is developing that dependency, they will keep updating it, they will keep improvising on it. So what happens is, if they keep improvising it, they will have a new version of that dependency, and because you are referring to the old version, there will be a break. Your application is going to crash because of this. So what we do is suggesting, nowadays what is suggested is, you will have your binary artifacts into place. You will need to store the your version, the application referring version of the binaries into this. So you can have binary artifacts into this, binary repositories, artifact repositories it is called as. So you can store it to them. Next is, security team should be an essential part of the cross-functional DevOps team. In traditional software development lifecycle, what happens is there is a project management team who can have both now, operations as well as the development together. They'll have, they can have one project manager, but two different teams and everything. But the security team is different. They treat the security team as a different. And what happens is, because of this, again, the collaboration becomes less. Here, the security team should be an essential part of the cross-functional DevOps enabled team. Every discussion, the security team needs to be part of, because they will point out to any security risks or gaps in that application right from the beginning. Ensure network security tools are deployed for each application. Log files for threats, attacks, etc. You need to have network security tools in place, right? That what we explained, that you have to keep monitoring the traffic, you need to keep monitoring the performance, and you have to do the and all such things. Secure infrastructure as code, server hardening built into automated scripts, like we explained, right? You can have scripts, then these scripts can be executed, and then you have your server up running, your VMs up running. So we can have infrastructure as code. Role-based access control to provide separation of duties to identity and access management. Traditionally, what happened was, every application has their own access and authorization domain that provides authentication to users. Now we have IDAM in place, identity and access management, where all applications are connected to this IDM. And this is one platform which will help all the applications to manage their this access and authorizations, so that if a user leaves the organization, there will be just one button where it says that the user no longer exists in the organization, and all the access will be revoked in all the applications. Add automated testing tool to test the security after every build for quick fix. We discussed this. After, once the developer checks into the code, the build tool will build the code, and then you need to have an automated testing. This is a shorter loop for the developer's feedback. Continuous visibility into vulnerabilities and configurations, a regular VA scan. So this is what, that you need to have scheduled VA scans on regular basis, so that you get to know the vulnerabilities of the application. Schedule SAS scans on daily basis on your source code, so that you get to know the if there are any gaps at the source code level, if there are any gaps at the application level. You need to continuously do a VA scans, continuously do the scans, continuously, so that you know you are getting more and more inputs out of it. monitor everything. You have your pipeline, you have your processes, you have automated everything. Now you need to monitor it. You have to check if whatever you have planned, whatever you have implemented, the pipelines, the automation and everything, is it working fine? Is it giving you the correct output? Is it not giving you the correct output? You have to analyze it. And from the statistic, you have to keep improving. So you have to monitor everything. This is tools and technologies. This is the last slide. So this is just the tools for each domain. So you can have a look at it. This is just for references. You are not promoting anything. It's just for references. And to summarize our discussion from both SSDLC and the DevSecOps, secure SSDLC, that is SSDLC, to be in place as continuous process to minimize risk. You need to have SSDLC. You need to have security practices right from the beginning, right from, you know, from the planning, from the requirements gathering phase. You need to have it on your when you're building the architecture, because for example, if there is any security gap in the architecture, your development team is not going to have is not responsible for the damage that has been done. And you can imagine if any change or any security risk exists at the architecture level, how much difficult it will be to change the entire development. So yes, you need to have security right from the beginning. Identify appropriate security requirements and remove controls at each stage. So you need to have reviews and checks and approvals in place at each stage. You need to have control gates. These control gates will determine that whether all the security requirements have been followed or not. Compliance to regulations and policies. Each organization will have its policies and regulations in place. The tools, the automations and everything, the compliance needs to be as per the policies as drafted by the organization. Importance of threat modeling, security testing, security configurations, and secure deployment. We discussed all of it. It's all required for the application development. Adoption of security into DevOps. DevOps gives us faster deployments. However, we also need to embed security into it. We also discussed DevSecOps and CI/CD pipeline. So how we can automate our processes.
Rajita, can you go back to 34 slides for 10 seconds or 5 seconds?
34? Page number is...
No, the product, the tools. Thank you.
Okay.
Hi, Prajakta. Is the presentation done with?
Yes, Shikha.
Okay. Great. We can now then move towards the question, taking the question and answers.
Sure, Shikha. I'm just going through the questions.
Yeah.
Hi Shika.
Yes, please continue.
So the very first question we see is that, is this approach same as DevSecOps, right? If I scroll up. So the SSDLC activities, which you just mentioned, are actually part of, can be part of DevSecOps, right? Those are SSDLC phases and which can be ingrained into DevSecOps. So for example, what Prajasha just talked about, this SAST, ingraining of SAST activity, or maybe, you know, the code review or the secure design, all aspects are very much part of DevSecOps. So it is not same, but yes, the activity can be part of DevSecOps. So to answer that question clearly. Then we have been asked, like, in development part, what is the best practice to review developed code? That is post development, who should review the code as per the SOD? So there are two parts to it to answer this question. So when the code is being developed, right, the particular development frameworks used by the teams, these SAS tools have a plugin that can be incorporated and hence the SAS feature, scanning feature can be used. So that is a part wherein developers can use this tools to scan the code to find a vulnerability. Second part is that post-development, the security team usually run the tool and to find the vulnerabilities on the overall source code. So both have a role to play there to answer in this question in that way. Then thirdly, we have been asked, like, on the sharing of this PDF. So anyways, it will be there as a part of your webinar portal in the, as a, you know, video, so people can revisit. Okay, then we ask, the question asked, how can we integrate SonarQube checks in our CI/CD pipeline? So it depends, like, you know, if you are using any particular tool, for example, you know, the, like, you know, Jenkins. So that there are plugins available for you know, SonarQube to be integrated with any of the tools being used during the CI/CD pipeline. So that has to be as per the, actually depends on the particular tool, the development framework being used. So I believe all the SAS scanning tools supports that. Prajita, you want to add in here something?
So I will add to it. So the Sonar server will generate the authentication tokens, which will be used to create a service connection with the orchestration tools, like we have Jenkins and so on. And then there will be scripts that will be used to execute the scans on the code.
So can you please explain a little bit on secure infrastructure as code? So see, the secure infrastructure, I mean, that if I understand this question correctly, this is more talking about the code, right? The code being placed and how the security can be incorporated around that. So there are two, three factors to that. One is the separation of duties, right? How we make sure that the access to the code is available to only the authorized persons. So just like the way we mentioned, right, PIM can be one of the features looked into, wherein privileged identity management tools can be implemented in organizations so that the only the authorized users are able to access the code. Secondly, we can have versioning, proper versioning, and build maintain a proper versioning and controls there so that the it can be tracked for any relevant changes. And thirdly, you can incorporate for an integrity perspective the feature available as code signing. So that will provide a security around the code which is there on the infrastructure.
So to add to it, we have different tools. Terraform is one of them. So we'll generate scripts. Right, in the scripts we will mention all the security parameters and everything, and we will execute them. Take an example, we'll execute on the hypervisor, and then a virtual machine will be generated. We'll mention for, along with security parameters, we'll also maintain, for example, we want to have a IIS set up on it, so we'll also mention the configurations for IIS. So we have all our configurations into that script, we just need to execute it. So likewise, we'll execute, that becomes your infrastructure as a code.
So on the secure coding practices for legacy language, that is one of the questions being asked. So there's a framework from OWASP, eSAPI framework, which supports the, you know, such legacy applications. And apart from that, there are some standards also, you know, there is something called, you can see CERT's library also, the CERT Institute's library, which actually has provided a lot of secure coding practice there. It is available, publicly available. And then there are some standards like, you know, for example, MISRA, a secure coding standard is there for such legacy applications, which can be followed. It is available. So there are standards available, just like we say OWASP. Okay, OWASP is completely can be followed for overall all the applications, all the programming languages. So similarly, we have additional standard, just what we mentioned. Anything apart from that?
Participants, if they have any questions, they can share it on the chat window. Are there any other questions? There is one more question regarding any free tool for SAST. Shilendra Prajakta.
See, usually what the output that we get from proprietary tools are of higher value than we get from the free tools. There are free tools available in the market. You can simply do a Google search for that. But what we have identified is in our research is that this proprietary gives us more efficiency, gives us good refined results as compared to the free tools. And maintenance wise also, these tools are better. The proprietary tools gives us a better maintenance also.
And just to add here, what Prajita just mentioned, like the free tool, I mean, you can go and visit the OWASP.org. It has given a list of all the SAS free tools. But however, the one thing to notice here is that not one single tool supports one, you know, all the languages. So it could be a combination of tools wherein you have to use to support, you know, different languages. If in case you really want to go and use the SAS tool, however, I just repeat the point which Prajita said, the accuracy of the results would definitely differ a lot as compared to the commercial tool. But yes, there are free tools available, and it is language dependent. Yeah, correct. SonarQube Community Edition is a free tool. I mean, again, that as you mentioned, you know, it has been seen that the result and the accuracy in the results, you know, as compared to the commercial tools, are not that much, good. So usually, you know, if a large organization usually prefer a commercial tool to conclude on the SaaS vulnerabilities, on the vulnerabilities in the application from SaaS perspective.
I have a question. Can I ask?
Yeah,
ma'am,
please.
If you have a question, please put it down in the chat window, because it is unfair for the others who are writing it down. Request you to please share it on the chat window.
Okay, fine. Yeah.
So there is a question for the Android development beginners. I mean, so I will just refrain, I mean, this question from being answered, because this is the scope of, this is from a security perspective. So you have an insight to this? I mean, I think this is purely from Android development, some particular tool being talked about.
No, from Android development, no, this is specifically for application. Yeah.
Correct.
Are there any other questions? Yeah, we have one more question, Shilendra.
I request Usha BA ma'am to, can you elaborate the question, how is security and SDLC towards model? I didn't get this question exactly.
That you know that all the stages of the SDLC remain the same irrespective of the model what we are choosing, but you, when you went on with the explanation, you went on with the waterfall model, correct? And you said that the security should be like, should be on the every stages of it. Now if that is
right.
The case, then all the models also will be on the security aspect. So my question was, the four stages of SDLC when you talk about, is it model oriented or it is the phase oriented?
It is phase oriented. And it is applicable to, ma'am, if you pick up to any of the models. So the So the tools and technologies, we haven't, you know, exhausted list of tools and technology. The list can go on actually, depending on the model.
Okay, so that you are able to tell you that, you know, tell us that and how the stages can be considered, taking an example of a waterfall model, because I was wondering how this can be done, you know, in the incremental model, how it happens. Or in the spiral model, how it happens, right?
So the requirement and design, right? So when you see it actually, see, some of the activities can be, you know, have to be in a, can be refrained or have to be taken in a different manner, because for example, threat modeling is a time consuming activity. You are right. So in this spiral model, right, you can again and again, you have to, you cannot do a threat modeling. So it is a practice wherein you define a strategy in the design, that what is the, actually, you know, what are the, all the requirements are set for the application. Obviously that could be set in the initial stages. So when you do a requirement design, you define a strategy how the security controls can be aligned to the ongoing this iterative or a spiral model. So we have to list down, at least from the requirement perspective, the all the related assets, as I mentioned in the discussion, and the relevant assets and the all the list of requirements exactly. I mean, from a functional perspective, I'm purely talking from functional requirement. So hence the team can actually, security team, help you elaborate, you know, this is the strategy which can use going forward for all the spiral models you're going to develop. So it could be most of the things could be common, because you know your underlying requirements may slightly differ. So accordingly, the team can again and again review the underlying, the base threat model, something like that. But one conceptualized baseline model should be there at the initial phase, and then once you go ahead and changing, you know, doing a spiral model or whatever, it can be refined as per the requirement. So that can also go in that fast pace. Can you explain us, there's another question, stride methodology. So see, stride, as I was mentioning, is a threat modeling approach. So you, one of the threat modeling approach, I know, or a practice, as you can say. So when you go for stride, actually you are classifying the threats into this different you know, wordings like STRIDs. S stands for spoofing, tampering, repudiation, information disclosure, denial of service, and the violation of privileges. So once you classify the assets threats into this category, it is very easy for you to then arrive and then actually put on the different threats under the this categorization. Example, spoofing, you can think like, you know, SQL injection, process scripting, or anything related to, from authentication perspective, can come into that category, any attack or any threat related perspective. So you think of example, like, you know, tampering, okay, that is something from an integrity perspective. So all the session related attacks, any tampering on the happening on the request being, you know, traversing from the client to this destination. So that can be categorized under the the tampering, right? So it is just a categorization, way of categorizing the threats under different terminologies as per the stride, and then arrive to a threat model. What are the security controls are required to be built in agile develop SDLC? How it is different from other models? See, as I mentioned, so your requirement and design are very, very much important at the initial stages, where you gather all the requirements, all the security controls, right? So you fit in your, you fit in all the requirement which till the deployment, and you highlight, you take all the inputs there in itself from the application team, and then design your strategy. So controls for agile agency is not differing actually here. What all we talked about in the discussion.
So I will add over here. What happens in an agile method is your project overview, your architecture and design is outside your agile. However, the other aspects like requirements gathering for the 2 weeks sprint planning, then your plan, your development, testing, and everything will be following the agile methodology. So your security practices that you want to follow will be applicable in each of these phases. So you understand you will have one set, that is your project vision, you can say your overview architecture of your application and your design. But these all also will require the security evaluations to be done. So apart from that, you will have your agile methodologies, you will have your planning, your requirements for that sprint, your development. So that will also again have your security practices. For every code, you need to have your scans to be done, you need your build tools to build, and so on. And then you will have your testing done on that piece of code for that sprint, and you likewise. So your security practices are not going to change depending on the model. They are going to be there.
So right, Vinita. So every sprint you are going to do a sort of a SAS and desk, and just to take an example, correctly mentioned. Can you explain about secure coding practices? So as we mentioned, the secure coding practices can be developed in-house based on certain guidelines. Like OWASP is one of the topmost, one of the most considered practices which is followed across the industry, which actually helps you building this guideline. And then, as I mentioned, the CERT also has secure coding guidelines practices, provided on their portal in terms of Java, .NET, or C++ programming languages. So you can refer this industry practices and, you define your secure coding practice for the organization.
Okay, I think all the questions have been answered. Okay, I think we've exceeded the time also. All right, thank you, Shilendra and Prajakta. I think it was a very enriching session, and I'm sure that the participants gained a lot of knowledge and insights. So thanks a lot for sharing your knowledge here today.
Thank you, Shikha. Thanks a lot to the team also for giving us this privilege to come on to this webinar and share our views on Secure Agency.
You're always welcome. Thanks a lot, Shilendra, Prajakta.
Thank you, Shikha. Thank you so much for inviting us.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, team.
Okay, so now we can move ahead towards the evaluation for all the attendees. I will be sharing the evaluation link. We will keep this open for 60 minutes. For all those who are asking a copy for the presentation, these are recorded webinars, so you can revisit them anytime later. We upload them on our YouTube channel, so you can revisit all our past webinars on our YouTube channel.